What's up, everyone? It's the Watch and Listen podcast. I'm your host, Matt Farah, and I do this little show here with my friend Cameron Weiss, the CEO of the Weiss Watch Company and master watchmaker. This episode is brought to you by Crown & Caliber, the number one place to buy a secondhand luxury watch on the internet. There are a lot of weird, shady things about buying watches over the internet, and the most important thing you can have with one of these transactions is confidence. Crown & Caliber sells legit watches. Their stuff is as advertised, and if it's not, they make it right. Use code CAM150, C-A-M-150, to get $150 off your first watch at Crown & Caliber. If you got an extra watch laying around, maybe something you don't wear so much anymore, you want to get rid of it, trade up, trade out, Crown & Caliber will buy your watch. That's how they get their stock. They have a fleet of watchmakers and technicians that can repair and service the watches as well. Again, code CAM150 gets you $150 off your first watch at CrownAndCaliber.com. Check it out. We're also sponsored by Beeline Coffee. I drink it every day. I used to drink it in the afternoon as well, but now I need to sleep a little bit more. And caffeine affects me a little more now because I'm 36. And when I was a kid, I used to do like quad shots at 7 p.m. Can't do it anymore. Now the Beeline Coffee is just in the morning. It's grown high up in the mountains. It's single origin coffee. It's absolutely delicious. It is as high quality coffee as they can make because if I'm going to work with a coffee company, it's not going to be to make money. In fact, they don't even really pay me. They just pay me in coffee. That's how much I like it. I don't get paid except in coffee. And that's okay. I have no problem with that. Use code CHRONO to get 15% off your entire order at Beeline Coffee. All right. This episode, Cameron and I are talking about pilot watches. I've been a little hesitant to do this one because I didn't know if we could fill an episode. To me, a pilot watch was really just a style more than anything else. But as we learn, there's a little more to it than that. We have some cool pilot watches in studio from Crown & Caliber. This is an interesting discussion. Here we go. It's an hour on pilot watches, the Watch & Listen podcast. Podcast. We're here. Cameron is polishing watches as we start the show. What's up, folks? Hello, Cameron Weiss.
Hello.
What's happening? How are you?
I've been melting.
It's hot here. We have an air-conditioned studio. It's lovely. Thank God. My home, not so much.
Yeah.
Your home, air conditioning?
No.
No?
No. I have a window unit, but it can't handle it.
Yeah. The Southern California, August is the hard times.
Yeah.
The rest of y'all are going to... You know, when you go home at the end of your summer, and we enjoy September, October, and November without you. That's how it goes. Today, it's pilot watches. We're talking about the most tool of tool watches, right? The original, not the original tool watch. That was probably a railroad pocket watch of some kind.
But you go from the railroads up into the air, and it's just another... another movement in technology and exploration.
It's the tool that put the watch on the wrist.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
It is. Santos Dumont, all of that.
We
got a mini Santos and a big Santos.
Yeah.
We're celebrating Santos. I want that one in that one size. We'll get to that. You know the drill. Welcome to the show. Follow Cameron on Instagram. Ooh, how about I make the window the correct size for the show? And it's Weiss Watch Company on Instagram. And then myself, that's my homepage. There's a chick on it. That's me. The Smoking Tire on Instagram. And of course, all my thesmokingtire.com, car videos, etc. Before we get into pilot watches, Cameron, I have a watchmaker question for you. I've experienced a phenomena. Two people have asked me about it. I don't know. I guess it's because I ended up talking about watch a lot recently, but I seem to be an expert to some people. And they ask me, like, their broken watch questions. I'm like, bro, I'm the student, not the fucking teacher in this show. So I have one for you. Two different watches exhibit the same behavior. One is a brand new Audemars Piguet Royal Oak chronograph.
Okay.
Did you talk to Nick? It was his.
I did not.
Oh, I gave him your number. He figured you might have. So, and the other is...
the Seiko Bellmatic that I bought from Nick Farrell at DC Watches. They both appear to keep good time. At least they haven't been put on a machine. That, and you know, wrist quality.
Yeah.
They appear good to enough. Keep good time. Yeah, yeah, good enough. Everything is fine. Nothing's weird. Both watches are left on nightstands overnight. The next day, both watches still telling time, but like a half hour behind. What happened there? What's
probably,
going on there?
Probably low on power.
That was it?
Yeah.
Just didn't have a full wind to begin with, and so it died. He just didn't notice it died when he put it back on and it got it going, but it died like just before the morning and he put it back on.
Or it was stopping. Could be stopping at I guess a half hour before you're putting it on.
That's what I mean. Runs out of power and stops.
Yeah.
All right. So that's it's not if a watch a watch could it have a hiccup and something gets stuck and then it doesn't have enough power to free itself if it gets stuck.
If,
right?
If it stops, it's stopped. It's not going to start back up on its own.
Right. It's not like
until you touch it and move it around.
It's not like getting your car like you know stuck in mud and just giving it a little more throttle. Like that's not it. Does it's not going to do that.
No. This is the Seiko. That one's an auto.
The Seiko is not only is the Seiko an auto, the Seiko is an auto that without any manual winding function at all. The manual wind only winds the alarm on that thing.
Yeah, so it's likely that the automatic winding mechanism is just not running efficiently.
Uh-huh.
So you wear it all day and it winds it enough so that it keeps accurate time.
Right.
But it doesn't wind it enough that you have however long you sleep, 8 hours, you know,
So if Hannah took it off at like 4 p.m. and didn't put it on until noon the next day, it could die.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. All right.
Yeah, it's pretty standard for an automatic watch to have that issue.
Really?
And it'll still keep perfect time on the wrist. But
it'll still keep perfect
stops
time.
When you take it off, yeah.
The Audemars Piguet, I was surprised because it was brand new. And you wore it for days straight. And then, so who knows?
That is interesting, brand new.
Yeah, I mean, I'm talking about like weeks old brand new.
Yeah, from the store and everything?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so it's probably just some bad oil on a reversing wheel.
Really?
Yeah.
So is that's a take it back?
Okay. Take, warranty correction on it. No problem. No big deal.
That's a bummer when you drop loots.
Yeah, but it does happen.
Of course
it
happens.
It's unfortunate. But
yeah.
The reversing wheels have these tiny little ratchet paws in them.
Uh-huh.
And if they're stuck in one position for a long time, they can tend to get stuck in
as
that
in
position.
It was produced sitting. And then sat in a box for a long time.
Yeah, so. Sat at the store.
Is that a problem that's more likely to happen in a watch that just sits?
Yeah.
As opposed to something that's worn consistently.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you for that. I'm glad to know. I will my solution was to put the Seiko back on a winder for like 12 hours before she used it again to get a full wind out
That'll
of it.
Do
but
it.
All right.
Yeah, it's not going to damage the watch to use it, but it is inconvenient.
Yeah.
You know, you have an automatic with a power reserve that can last through the night for that reason, so you
don't have
to set it every morning.
But I guess in a vintage automatic, the power reserve's maybe just not that long in the less expensive watches.
Yeah, you'll end up with like a 30-hour power reserve in some of those ones.
Uh-huh.
But it's still long enough to get you through the night if it is actually...
Yeah. It's 30 hours, but it was 30 hours 40 years ago. Like, I don't know.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know what's going on.
Exactly.
So, should we talk about pilot's watches?
Yeah.
Normally, you know, if we're doing history of something, I'd have, like, notes, and I'd go through some kind of corporate history of this one. Honestly, you wanted to do pilot watches. This was your suggestion. Here's where I throw you under the bus. I am going to say that I like pilot watches, to me, for the most part, are really just a style of watches. They're not, none of them have a particularly special movement or function to me. It's a watch designed by legibility, loom, a big clear face, you know, and that's kind of really it. A chronograph possibly. But so what is a pilot watch to you? What inspired you to say, let's do a show about pilot watches?
I think kind of along the same lines. All of those legibility, big crowns, and really bold indices, hands that just jump off the dial, easy to read. I think mostly it's stylistic. I don't think But the same thing with dive watches nowadays. Most people aren't diving in dive watches.
Yeah, I mean, I guess, and you can't dive really to like 600 meters anyway. I mean, your body will get crushed before your sea dweller will. Now that I'm interested in watches, I fly a lot. I look at what current pilots, at least commercial pilots, are wearing. Generally, not pilot watches, honest. You know what they wear a lot, I think? The current pilots, like, at least on Delta, I see a lot of those like Citizen Eco Drives, like the solar watches I see, watches that that self-adjust to time zones, GPS watches. Like, I see those a lot with current pilots today.
I agree. And the people I've spoken to, that's what they go for as well. Because I've asked some pilots and people who fly, and they're not so interested in like the IWCs and Breitlings and, you know, Rolex, whatever. They don't really care. It's the biggest thing is the fact that it adjusts itself when you get into a new time zone so that you're not calling home in the middle of the night or, you know, you have an idea of what the time is and you can figure out what time it is at home easily.
Right. So actually, my GMT is in the other room, which technically is a pilot watch as well.
Yeah.
All right. So it's really, let's just like look at some and see what happens.
Yeah.
So we'll go back to the beginning again. How many fucking shows can we talk about the Santos? But bring them out.
It was a big deal.
It was a big deal. Cartier, 1904, I believe. 1910. Early 1900s. Louis Cartier and the pilot, Alberto Santos Dumont, work together to put a watch on a wrist. And this is the current version of it. It's little. It comes in sizes now.
Yeah.
Small, medium, large. So is that the small or the medium?
That's probably a medium.
I think that's the medium. The small is really small. And then here's the XL, the biggie. Yeah. I got that XL. So the XL, this is a black rubberized bezel steel. And then we've got the steel with the gold hardware and the gold bezel. Ooh. The steel and gold in the big size is my jam.
Yeah.
Actually, so this one, the one on the viewer right, is the XL100. It's from a couple of years ago. It's actually the older style. And the one on the other one is the new, brand new style. It's a cool watch, man. It's simple, three-hander, not particularly special. Movement, but I felt really cool wearing it. I don't know why.
Yeah. It looks completely different from any other watch.
Yeah,
the square with that the bezel and the screws on it. It's noticeable.
It definitely is. I felt cool wearing it. I liked it. And Cartier, you know, they're the horologists fashion watch or the fashionistas. High, hot watch.
The fashionistas of hot horology.
Yeah, you know, because they don't make them complicated, right? They just make this. They do their classic. Everything about it is a classic. But so that's where it all started. It's funny that's where it started, and Cartier still does it, but like nobody else, you know, everyone else took a different direction with a pilot watch.
Right. Most people that describe a pilot watch today would never describe the Cartier Santos.
No.
Never.
No. This would you describe it as like the Jackie O watch and then like the Joey Goomba watch, which is fine by me. I like Joey Goomba. Joey Goomba's funny for me.
Right.
But they're very pretty, and that's where pilot watches start, and it's the only pilot watch that looks like that now, right?
Definitely.
Is there another one?
Not one that I know of. No. I mean, I look at this, and I have a hard time quickly reading the time. It's a square watch. It's not easy.
Yeah,
it makes it a little tricky.
And all the it's weird. It's actually worse on the XL one. The Roman numerals, especially on the 6, 7, 8, 8 area, they really smush. They smush together.
Right.
They're smaller and more legible actually on the other ones. Although reading Roman numerals upside down and on a 45 degree angle, it's upside down and backwards.
Yeah. You just have to know.
Yeah.
You have to know.
God forbid you know what direction 7 is on a clock. Yeah. But that's where it starts. It starts in a good place. And then you very quickly really transition to the World War I, World War II pilot watch, which is pretty much like where we stayed, right?
Yeah. I mean, from there, it grew a little bit, though.
It got bigger.
It got bigger.
Yeah. So is this where we start, pretty much? This is a newer watch. This is the old, the original style. This is an IWC.
Yeah, this is the Mark 11.
IWC. It's just it's just listed on here as IWC Pilot's Watch. All the watches we're featuring today are going to be on sale at Crown and Caliber like next week. Both of those Santoses. The small one's 2150. The big one's 4200. In case you're wondering. So this IWC Pilot's Watch. It's small. It's like a 38, maybe.
I believe so. 38 or 39.
38 or 39. This is your basic model, right? It's got a date, but it's a three-hander, bright, clear, legible numbers, big-er sized crown. It gets bigger from here, but
yeah, well, exactly. This one has a pretty small crown compared to a lot of the other dive watches, or not dive watches.
Wrong pilot show, watches. Bitch.
As opposed to the other pilot watches.
Well, isn't that kind of a you maybe want to have some adjustability with gloves on?
Yeah.
Is that? I can't possibly imagine trying to adjust the time on this thing with gloves on.
No, not with this one, not at all. No. It's a pretty small crown. It might be like maybe a 5 millimeter crown, which is pretty tiny. Some of the big onion shaped crowns.
Yeah, we've
like,
got that Zenith pilot watch. Zenith.
I'm not sure what they.
I think it's
prefer.
Zenith. I think it's Zenith. It sounds better. In my head, I say Zenith.
Right.
But
look at the size of that.
That's the
that
big
onion crown.
The big onion crown.
Yep.
I like the name onion crown. Also, I like onions and garlic. And we're having a crown reminds me of it. I got the big onion on my IWC. I like it.
Yeah.
It's actually it's a fun thing to have a big onion crown like that.
Yeah.
What's the style of the small crown called?
Just crown, I guess.
Regular boring crown.
Yeah, regular boring crown.
The Zenith Pilot Watch. I really like the numbers. They remind me of those sort of old school, like Corps of Engineers watches numbers. That's big numbers, really big numbers.
Yeah, and I think for me, a pilot watch has luminescent numerals.
Yeah,
completely filled in so you can see the actual digit. Big numerals, big hands as well. Something that that's just easy to read because you don't want to. You want it to look kind of like
a
dashboard
it's
of
a gauge.
You know?
Yeah,
because you're looking at all these big gauges, and then if you look at this tiny little watch that barely glows, that wouldn't be very useful in a cockpit, I don't think.
Yeah, I mean, think like you know, to go back in the day, you know, the lights that they had in the cockpits were like way dimmer.
And yeah,
you know, if you go back far enough, we're talking about like open cockpit planes.
Yeah,
you know,
and it's just like driving. You don't want to have a whole bunch of lights in the cockpit to read your watch. You get a whole bunch
so
of glare.
Weird. It's so weird. I kind of like bright. I like my dashboard pretty bright.
Yeah.
In the car, whenever like my friend Thaddeus or whoever people drive my cars, they always turn my dashboard down like super dim, and I maybe my eyes are just fucked and need bright, but. I totally feel you with the bright loom is really the defining characteristic. Legibility, bright loom, big face occasionally. This IWC would be a good entry level watch. It's like it's a real tool watch. I bet that watch is just tough.
Yeah, and that's an older design as well. So it's from a time when watches were just simply smaller.
Yeah.
That was the style.
And that IWC is $4,000. The Zenith is $5,600. Let me see that.
IWC is actually a limited edition as well.
Is it?
Yeah.
Limited to what?
I think it's 1600.
Really?
Or no, it's 1948 because that would have been the year that
that's
it was
the
introduced.
Year.
Yeah. So 1948.
It is like it's very pretty. If you like a small to medium sized watch, that's like that would look like a big watch on a small person. Or a small watch on a big person.
Yeah, I think it's a nice average size.
Yeah.
But they've got the triangle up at 12 as well, I think is a
that's kind
a
of
big
a hallmark
design
as well,
element,
right?
Yeah.
All right, help me out here. Is this a...
That's a screw-down crown.
This is a screw-down crown on the Zenith, but here.
Yes.
What is the pusher button...
So that's going to be your GMT
is
hand.
A GMT quick-set hand. So
it's
just
a really
demo that
because nice.
It's awesome.
So you've got the big screw-down onion crown, and it just... feels amazing. It's awesome because it's so huge. But then you've also got up here at around 10 o'clock, you have a big button. You can operate that with some huge gloves on, no problem.
Yeah.
But you see the red hand will jump around just the push of a button. You don't have to unscrew the crown or
do
anything.
No, I was going to say, you don't have to unscrew the crown.
You just push the button and it's jumping around the 24-hour marks. You can kind of see them on the video a little bit. They're in red, but they're quite a bit smaller than the 1 through 12.
It's a really cool watch. Flip it over. It's got a nice little engraving on the back, too. I hope you guys are enjoying this shade. If I pull up this, look at this. Look at the, the, if you're watching, I made Cameron a cardboard shade. It makes it really hard for him to see.
A little cardboard and packing tape.
Oh, what's on the back of that? It's like a biplane.
Yeah. And this is a limited edition as well, I believe.
That's a very pretty watch. If you're about an all black, like that is a sweet, like I just having picked it up and felt it, the click of that button is super, super satisfying.
Right. And
I like that one.
So this black one, it's titanium as well.
Oh.
So for being a pretty large pilot watch, it's not that heavy.
Let me see.
Weight to it, but not...
It's not that heavy. Yeah. Oh, the Navitimer is definitely heavier. This is a really neat watch. If you're into pilot watches and you're into black, because it's very black.
Yeah.
None more black. It's big. It's
but
like
that
a,
makes the, it's like a 48 the or something. Stand out big time.
It's kind of cool, man. I mean, oh, this band is a little beat up. Band's a little sloppy. Look at this. So I got a big wrist. It even looks big on me. That's good, though, right?
Yeah.
It's big, bold, easy to read. The lugs you were commenting.
Yeah,
what are these
lugs
like?
On there.
It's what is the... Throw that back under there. What it's got... Do they have names, those lugs? They're really cool.
They have like a square profile, but they've got these screws on the side as well. So it's like a square, square part protruding out of the case rather than being... integrated into the case like one piece. They're actually placed there and then screwed, bolted into the case.
Oh, interesting.
It's a neat construction, and it just adds to the profile view of the watch, I think. It makes a nice little touch on there having those extra screws.
It's a beautiful watch.
Yeah.
I feel like that'd be a good everydayer, that thing. But you gotta have a big wrist. You gotta be a bold person with a big wrist to wear that thing.
Yeah.
It's cool, but for $5,600, that feels like a lot. That's an in-house movement, yeah? Zenith? No?
I'm not sure about this movement.
Zenith Type 20?
Yeah, let's look it up.
Let's look it up.
Type 20 GMT.
Type 20 GMT. Oh, it comes in a few different colors, too.
It might you be based it, off the 7750, but...
You can get it in a... you can get it in regular stainless steel. You can get it in titanium. There's a lot of options here. The movement is, do we see? Here we go. Just says automatic. Wait, yeah, it just says automatic.
Try typing in in their search for the movement, yeah.
What kind of movement you'll use? It's probably really, really interesting content for the folks. We could have looked this up before, possibly. Zenith Type 20 DMT. Do you see anything?
I do not.
We'll bring it to the people. Automatic. I don't see the number.
I don't know for sure, but my guess would be that it's based off the 7750, the Edo 7750.
Okay. All right. So if it's not an El Primero, it's not an El. It's not going to be a Zenith movement.
Yeah, I don't think so.
Is that Quickset GMT proprietary, you think?
Probably something that was made by one of the makers like Dubois Dupras.
Oh yeah, okay.
But like good. They make the best.
Would that is that that a G, that would be a GMT module?
Yeah.
I like it. So let me think. So is that button going to be off centered with the crown then? Off alignment, higher up?
Probably, unless you have, sometimes the switch comes off the top of the movement, and then it is actually a formed piece of metal that goes down the side.
Okay.
So then you can actually have the button still right in the middle of the case, rather than up to the front.
Wow! In looking for this information, look at this other version of this watch I found. That's dope.
Nice. The antique bronze.
Look at that. It says extra special on it. That's so
right.
Weird.
The crown looks good in that
that's
color with the
fire though.
With the dark lines.
Yeah, that's right? Super fire. How old is this forum? Who even knows? Really old. That looks awesome.
Yeah.
Cool. What else do we have for watches to look at?
Let's go
straight to the B&R. Dude,
to the legit gauge.
Every time I throw on this Bell & Ross, the last Bell & Ross Crown and Caliber sent us had like this, like an ace bandage strap on it with Velcro and shit. And I was not about it. This one's got this cool beastie, like cuff like leather thing.
Yeah.
It's actually like very punk rock. I kind of dig it.
Right? The nice, yeah. nice stitches too. To...
Bell and Ross is great. They look really look like aviation type gauges. Like with the four screws too. The four yeah. screws, it looks like. Oh, I could take this and screw it into my dashboard.
Right.
You know? I've been close to buying Bell & Ross a couple times. I like their new round watches. I'm gonna pull up some pictures of their new round stuff. But the square is really like the defining, you know, Bell & Ross. Ooh, look at that. Is that a dive watch, Bell & Ross?
Yeah.
Whoa, the BR32. Diver was, in blue.
Yeah, here's their
round.
Look at
this round one. The vintage BRV2 94 RS18 carbon fiber dial. I love what they're doing with their dial designs and their use of colors. This has red and carbon, and then yellow and black, and then almost like a Speedmastery bezel happening. Like really neat. That thing is dope, dude. But back to the pilot watch.
I think their designs, they've been picking up quite a bit.
Yeah.
Been doing well lately.
We may have to do a history of Bell & Ross, I think. So here's, you know, your typical, if we're going with the Bell & Ross in vintage style, you know, the square is really the trademark, the hauling, what the fuck?
the skull? The skull, yeah.
Let's go right past those. We don't need those. This is really the hallmark. The square case screwed together, the four numerals, big bolt. Is it like the same font as Panerai?
It's pretty it's similar.
It's close, right?
It's close, but it's probably not exact.
So you can get there's a 42, 46, a 42, and a 39, and this is the 39, actually, I believe. Isn't it?
I don't know if that's a 39. That's pretty big.
I think it's 39.
I think it's 42.
You do?
Yeah.
BR03? Oh, it's BR... Not. Oh, yeah, BR03.
BR03-92S.
Okay. Sorry. It's a 42. I apologize.
And you have that awesome little screw.
Yeah, the do not remove screw.
I love that.
It just says...
I want to remove that screw.
Just says do not unscrew.
Yeah. I love that.
Every time I put one of these on, I'm like, I should own one of these, though. They're really... It feels cool. It's like... It's like wearing a cuff, kind of.
Yeah.
I think they're nice to tell time. They're really bright at night. The looms are cool. You know, fun watches.
Yeah, by far one of the most legible watches.
Yeah. And every time I kind of like see somebody wearing one, I'm like, yeah, watch guy. You know, you can like, you know, because of the distinctive shape, you can spot it from like across the street.
Yeah.
So I mean, look, if you throw it on, it's pretty cool with the cuff like that.
So I guess, you know what? There's another square
there's another
pilot
square
watch.
One. That's a
just
good point.
Like
did I say
the
there was
Santos? But it's got a round dial.
The round dial on the square watch is cool.
Right?
It works. It's man, if you put it on too tight though, it really strangles your wrist with this beefy strap.
Yeah.
What kind of movements are these things using?
Those will be ETA and Salido movements.
Uh-huh. I like
but
that it's got the date window
the
at the 4 o'clock, but it's straight up vertical date. That's
yeah.
nice. For the price, how much is this big? This BNR Bell & Ross Aviation $32.50.
Right,
not
solid price for a really unique watch.
Not bad, and something
an awesome
you could
movement.
You could wear like you could wear this with almost anything. Like,
yeah,
you'd have to be pretty boss to pull that off with a suit, but you'd wear it with anything else.
Yeah,
it's a cool watch, man. What else do we have? Yeah, there was an IWC chronograph or something also, right?
Yeah.
And then we'll get more interesting. We'll do chronograph, then we'll do nav timer, and then we have the big mamma jamma ejecto cito watch. That's the ultimate in pilot's watches. I thought... Oh. Well, we'll cover... There's another type of pilot's watch. We'll cover it next week with Breitling because we're not... The Breitling Emergency is also a pilot, an interesting pilot's
yeah.
watch. But next week is all Breitling, and so we're skipping it today. But fear not, we just don't want to talk about it two shows in a row. Here's another IWC. This one's a big pilot, and it has a calendar, and a chronograph, and it is very, very pretty, and it is much more expensive. Oh, no, it's not.
Shouldn't be too bad.
Actually, it's less. It's $3,800. It's less than the limited edition smaller one.
Yeah, the so the limited edition one is going to have an in-house movement.
Uh-huh.
And it's limited edition. It's that's the reason for the higher price. It's a more collectible watch. More collectors are looking for that watch. And I'll throw that on the screen.
Zoom out.
But the chronograph one's going to be 7750 base, so at a movement, and not as limited.
Yeah, and it's not that awesome like Paul Weber movement like I have on my Big Pilot Perpetual.
No.
Oh.
No. Well, this one's just regular chronograph with day and date. But it's got
You can get the Big Pilot stuff with all of the Paul Weber movement without all the fancy stuff, right?
Yeah.
Oh, because this is an IWC Pilot, not a big pilot. That's the difference.
Yeah.
Yeah, you got.
So this just has a regular
a multiplication factor on that one.
Yeah.
This IWC, the dial is busy to me, man. It's actually like, for a pilot watch, it's actually like kind of tough to read.
Yeah, I think that's from the day and date.
Mm-hmm.
And then you also have your three chronograph registers. It makes it a little busy, especially with the date where they have the three dates visible.
Like,
look kind of like your airplane, like your pitch,
whatever that is
for the level of the wings.
I don't know what it's called either.
Yeah,
sorry.
But whatever that is. That tells you you're not flying sideways or upside down.
yeah. A horizon line?
Yeah, right? I think something like that.
Something like that.
Yeah.
I just think it's a kind of a busy dial. But, I mean, I suppose the main three hands you can see well, but
yeah.
It's not my favorite of the IWC line. Anyway.
but again, it's got the triangle up there.
What's the significance of the triangle?
I don't even know. It must have been a design element that was included on one watch, and then everyone just kind of started adding that to their watch. It's very recognizable, so you can quickly see 12.
Here's I just Googled this. The timely meaning of the triangle. Okay. The triangle, two dots, the 12 o'clock position. The history of the pilot's watch. Oh, boy. Here we go. Hang on. The upward facing triangle surrounded by two. Was it just making it easier to start and stop the watch at 12 because it would go in between? And only the indices and not the numerals created with luminescent material. Got it.
There you go.
Okay, so back in the day, you would have a watch face, but the numerals would not be lit up, but there'd be markers on the outside of the numerals, and so the triangle would indicate which of those markers was 12.
Yeah, so in case your hand's at a little bit of an angle,
right,
you don't mess that up.
So after that, someone was like, you know, we're already putting these numbers on this thing.
Yeah.
We could probably just mark the numbers.
Yeah.
All right, so it's a throwback. I mean, that's all... Aren't all pilots' watches throwbacks at this point?
I think so.
It's exclusively a throwback scenario.
Yeah. I don't think... if there's any pilots out there, you can tell us if you've ever been required to have certain type of timepiece or certain functions.
But right.
From what I've read and people I've talked to, it really doesn't matter. It could be anything. It just has to tell time. It could be just a little timer that you tape onto your dash.
Anything
doesn't have to be a special pilot watch. It's not like the ISO standards for dive watches or anything like that.
Right. They don't even have to be chronometric necessarily.
Yeah.
Chronometer certified, which we'll talk about with Breitling again tomorrow. Speaking of Breitling, let's throw the Breitling in. This is the Breitling Navitimer, which is do you need to take that strap apart or can you make that work without
it? I'll make it work.
So the Breitling Navitimer is a busy watch. It's really sort of the classic pilot's math watch. It's got a slide rule bezel, so
totally
it's
different from the IWC and the other
big
pilot watches, where you have easily legible hands and big numerals that glow and a very like plain dial where you have black and white, easy to see everything. This one, it's like, how do you even see the hour and minute hand?
It is really hard to see what the hell is going on this watch.
It's very busy.
Covered in numbers.
Right.
So you sort of know how to operate this device. I tried and like kind of failed at it. So
it's basically a calculator where you have an outer scale and then you have an inner scale on the dial. So the outer scale, you're aligning it with different markers on the inner scale in order to do calculations. So if we align...
The new shield 10, is making that hard. Sorry.
Yeah, sorry. So over here...
I'm going to try to zoom in on it for the video, folks.
Yeah.
It's going to be really hard to read. So in between...
In between 2 and 3.
2 and 3 is a red number 10.
So if we line up the red number 10 on the inner dial with the number 10 on the bezel dial, which is white on this watch...
They're lined up right now.
You can look anywhere on the other numbers, and you can actually see... You can do multiplication now. So if you've got... like over here, you see everything. Your 10 on the outer scale multiplied by any one of these is actually your answer over here.
So 10, and if you go over to 40, you have to add a decimal place. So it's 10 times 40 is 400.
Yes.
It is really nice that we don't have to do this anymore.
Yeah, and this
is just
will
for
do
display now.
Multiple decimal points. So you kind of have to know where you're at, what you're expecting the answer to be.
Yeah.
In order to get it.
Yeah, but it'll give you the first two numbers of any problem.
Yeah, and even the scale, some of the indices are not equal numbers. They're fractions, but they're not listed. There's no numerals next to them, so you have to kind of guess. And it's a tough way of doing things. I prefer the digital calculator a little more.
Really have to do math, I think this watch is not the answer anymore. But you can do multiplication. You can apparently do division. You can do speed and distance, So here, to do speed and distance, let's see. When incorporated into a bidirectional rotating bezel, they are means of calculating fuel consumption, flight time, ground speed, wind impact, and rapid unit conversions. Currency and temperature conversions, which is basically just math, division, multiplication, and fuel consumption. So if you're flying a plane that burns 22 liters of fuel per hour and that the flight will last 4 hours or 240 minutes, to calculate fuel consumption, position 22 opposite the hour marker at 12 and read off the figure at 24, which is 88. Let's try that. So your plane, Cameron, burns 18 liters of fuel per hour. So position 18 on the outer ring opposite the hour marker at 12, so the top marker. And then read off the figure at 240 minutes, parentheses, 24.
So it should actually... Because this is a 24-hour dial, this was designed for a 24-hour dial, the 12 is actually going to be down at 6.
Right.
So you also have to watch out for that, because now they're not actually... Your hour hand is not a 24-hour hand on these anymore.
Oh, but in this math that it's giving me, it is?
But the slide rule setup is a 24-hour...
Oh, fuck off.
Yeah,
really?
So it's a little... It's
so it actually doesn't even work anymore?
Ones. It works,
you just
but
have to do...
you just have to know that.
Oh.
So on the old ones, they actually had the hour hand moved around your dial every 24 hours.
Okay, yeah.
These ones, not the case. So,
bro, you're killing me with this difficulty.
Right? It's a tricky one. So it's a little different. You still have your GMT hand up here?
Yeah. So do you do all the math based on the GMT hand then instead of based on the regular hour hand?
Yes. Yeah. Because of the slide rule.
Okay.
So we set the 18 to around what looks like 6 o'clock.
Uh-huh.
There's actually a 24 on the dial there that we're setting it to.
Right.
So aligning it with the 24 or with the 12 on the GMT scale of the dial. This is why this dial looks so busy. There's so much going on.
There's so much going on. I'm so confused.
So we've got 18 down at the bottom of the watch.
Uh-huh.
And then what was the
next
step?
And we have a
step?
Flight that lasts 240 minutes. So position 18 opposite the hour marker at 12 and read off the figure at 24.
At 24.
Yeah, so up at the top. What's the figure there?
Looks like about 58, so we got all right, something so we, wrong.
Yeah, no, it's correct because right? I changed the number. Yeah, I changed it from 22. So yeah, perfect. So you just calculated how much fuel will burn in 4 hours. And 240 minutes. There
all right,
go.
And we'll get to our destination that way? Or
yeah, sure.
Crash and
no,
burn?
I mean, we're going to crash and die, but we're going to crash and die very fashionably.
Yeah.
It's a busy dial, but like, so I'll say Seinfeld loves these. Seinfeld is all about the nav timers.
I love these watches too. I mean, it really is one of the original like tool pilot watches.
Yeah.
But it's just hard to read. It's hard to use, but yeah. I like it. I like the scallop bezel. I love the design.
What percentage of people that own these fucking things know how to use any of that shit?
You might read the booklet the first time, and then you forget the second time you wear it, and you never use it ever again.
I like how it looks on my wrist. I set that up. I put this on and went, oh, this is going to become my loner. I didn't think I was going to like it, but when I put it on, it actually felt pretty cool.
Yeah. Like, hey, who knows? You could become that guy that when someone's like, hey, how much do we tip on this? You know, you want to leave a whatever 18% tip, and then he pulls out his little Breitling calculator on the bezel and starts doing some equations. You could be that guy.
No, never.
Instead of the cell phone,
I'm not going to be that guy. There's just like there's numbers all over this thing.
Everywhere
is the opposite of the rest of the pilot watches.
Yeah,
our last pilot watch, I think, is really interesting. Tell us about this. It looks like it's pronounced Bremont. Is it just Bremont or is it Bremont or some shit like that?
I say Bremont.
Okay, great. If you say Bremont, so will I.
Because they're not
they're
French,
English,
Swiss,
right?
They're English.
They're English. So it's just Bremont. It looks like it is. Thank God. This is the MB2, and the MB2, Cameron, is
so the MB2 is the civilian issue watch. That was basically they designed this watch to give to or sell to people who had actually ejected from a Martin Baker ejection seat.
Like in a fighter plane.
In a fighter plane.
Yeah, yeah. So the watch is designed to withstand ejection from a fighter plane.
Yeah. Serious amount of G's, I would imagine.
Yeah.
I don't know the exact number, but I'm sure it's...
So it's shockproof.
Yeah, shockproof, and you can see on the dial
it says
even
anti-shock there.
Yeah, which that was common a long time ago when shockproof was a new feature, but now it means something totally different. It used to be just like the Inca block that we have talked about having something for the balance wheel, but this is a whole nother level of shockproof abilities. I guess they've tested it for all kinds of very intense shocks.
So it has a special heat-treated case. Heat treating and carbon diffusion process increases the hardness level to 2,000 Vickers, about 7 times the hardness of standard 316L steel, which will ensure the case looks great after years of wear. That sounds good, right?
Yeah.
It then has a sapphire crystal, has a titanium or DLC middle barrel and a stainless steel case back.
Yeah, and this one has the... So you have an internal, you have your time up at 2 o'clock, your crown there.
Yeah.
So you can set your time and do your date. But then down at 4 o'clock, you have another one for the inner bezel.
I love an inner bezel.
Right?
Love it.
But super industrial looking with the knurling.
Yeah. I like that. You know what those knobs remind me? I have a Seiko Turtle in that. Is that knurling? Is that what that's called?
The roughing.
The roughing. It's cool. I like it. You get a good grip on it. You feel like secure when you tighten it.
Right.
But it's water resistant, shock resistant, G-force resistant, magnetic field resistant. Pretty cool watch.
Yeah. And you see there's that anodized coating on the titanium center there.
Really cool. Here's movement. It's a modified ETA 2836 labeled as the BE36AE by Bremont. This is a reliable workhorse automatic movement, certified chronometer for accuracy within -4 to +6 a day by COSC. 38-hour reserve. 38 hours reserve. It is. It's a nice watch. I think we've been in contact a bit with some executives at Bremont. Right, they're going to come on the show and talk. I think
when they're in town. I believe so.
I think they said they would when they come to town. Awesome. Right.
They're another interesting brand, kind of swimming upstream, making watch parts outside of Switzerland. And from the top, it looks like a super simple case. And then I think from the side, that is a really cool addition to the case. It makes it almost, it kind of looks, reminds me of a propeller or something. The shape of the lugs, the backside.
Right. I don't know,
for some reason, that makes me think of two plane props. And then the way that the case fits together and those crowns.
It's cool. It's on the smaller, how big is it? 40?
Maybe 42.
Is it that big?
Yeah, I'd say 42.
It looks nice. I like it. We definitely, guys, come on the show if you're out there. That's about the most specific thing you could need from a pilot's watch, right? Survive ejection seat.
Yeah. that's pretty specific to be in highly, an airplane that even has an ejection seat.
Yeah, highly specific.
Yeah.
And so this is the MB2. Apparently, if you actually do eject and survive, they give you something called an MB1, which is the same watch as this. It just has different colors, and you can only get that one.
Yeah, if you have ejected, then you need to, I guess, get your number of the seat or something like that.
Yeah.
There's some kind of paperwork that you fill out.
I've ejected from bars. I've ejected from house parties. Never from aircraft, though.
Yeah. So anyone out there that has, fill out your paperwork and get your watch.
That's very cool. That Bremont is, what does my sheet say? That Bremont is, it's only $3,200. I mean, that's a lot of toughness for $3,200. It really is. I mean, especially it's anti-magnetic and anti-shock. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
I like that a lot. So we're going to send all these back to Crown & Caliber. They'll all be for sale next week on their website. Some of them already are. So thank you to that. I don't even know. I think, I don't have anything else. We can get more pilot watches in here and show them. But
I mean,
like,
there's so many pilot watches, a lot of historical ones. And then I kind of like the fact that everyone has a different opinion of what a pilot watch is.
Do they?
I think, yeah. Oh, just ask watch nerds. Everyone's got their own opinion of the best pilot watch, whatever.
What's the difference? So here's one. I mean, you make a field watch.
Yes.
So what's the difference between a pilot watch and a field watch?
That's the thing. Field watch is another one of those watches that is like, what is a field watch?
To me, a field watch is like of the style that would have been issued to a soldier in World War II or the Korean War,
right?
Or something. That's how I see a field watch.
That's how I feel about a field watch, too. I think historical military element.
Yeah.
Paired with something that is reliable and you could wear every day.
Yeah.
That's really my only criteria for a field watch.
Yeah. You could make a pilot watch, though. I mean, it wouldn't.
Yeah.
There wouldn't. For you to go to a pilot watch is really just a different case and dial design. I mean, you can use your movement on a pilot watch,
right? It could be as simple as a different crown and a different dial.
Yeah, I mean, if you put big numbers and loom on yours and then an onion crown, like, boom, Weiss pilot watch.
I mean, look.
What do you have there?
We'll put this up next to the the Zenith or something, right?
Yeah.
I mean, as far as the IWC goes,
similar,
right?
It's pretty similar other than white dial black numbers not working for a pilot watch. Unless the whole, why don't you do that where the whole dial is loom?
Right?
Yeah.
But then, you know, maybe onion crown?
Yeah, onion crown,
loom numerals,
different shaped hands, like more arrow-like hands maybe, and bigger loomed numerals, and then you've got a pilot watch.
And then you go from field watch to pilot watch.
Boom.
Yeah.
Done. Coming soon. Coming 2019. Send your pre-orders in.
Yeah.
Send your money, weisswatchcompany.com.
Yeah.
So that's pilot watches. There it is. We'll do it. I guess leave comments if you want to see more pilot watches, if you think that we haven't, in 47 minutes, beating this to the ground. Let us know. My favorite of this group, I think, has got to be the... I think think the Bell and Ross, actually. I think the Bell and Ross is the one I'd most like to own. But I think this Navitimer is what I'm going to borrow for a week.
Yeah.
Yeah? What would you like to own in this pile?
I would like to own the IWC Mark
the vintage,
11.
The little vintage one?
Yeah.
You're a little.
But you could tell. I mean, look at how I styled my watch.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That IWC has like a weird rubberized thing.
Yeah, it's like a green canvas, except it's not canvas. It's rubberized.
Yeah.
And then the back is like a Lorica material, which is a synthetic leather.
Yeah.
That won't, they can handle sweat and water and everything like that without falling apart.
Yeah, I just put your watch, or my watch that you made, I took it off that leather NATO and went back onto the canvas with that Lorica on it. That band works with that watch really well. That's
yeah.
fucking sweet. I love that thing. Great watch. That man, Cameron knows how to make a watch, folks.
Thank you.
Weiss Watch Company on Instagram. Get your watches here. And then, you know, you can follow me, Matt Farah, on Instagram. And then, of course, Crown and Caliber, where you can buy everything you see here, including this Breitling, once I'm done with it. Speaking of Breitlings, that's going to be next week, the history of Breitling, for which I do have homework and notes. Thank you for listening to Watch and Listen. Thank you for watching Watch and Listen. Goodbye.